by we the people. That is why. How many of you have been to a Culp campaign rally before? All right, we have a lot of new people. So I will introduce myself to you, tell you a little bit about my history, why I'm running, what led me down this path, and then we can talk about some issues. That sound good?
I grew up in a small farm
that is not a UFO, Washington. Right outside of Port Townsend in Jefferson County. My dad was a deputy sheriff for the Jefferson County Sheriff's Office. And I went through grade school, junior high, and my freshman year of high school, my dad got out of law enforcement and they moved us to the small mountain town called Republic. Has anybody been to Republic? It's a very beautiful little mountain town founded on gold mining and timber. At the age of 19, I joined the United States Army. I served in the world famous 101st Airborne Division. I will honor our law enforcement and our military and veterans every single day as your next governor, guaranteed. We have got to return law and order to the state of Washington. Are you with me? So I was serving the citizens where I work, going about my duties. And you remember back in 2018, an anti-gun initiative passed in this state, right? 1639. It made it against the law for military-age young adults to buy a semi-automatic rifle, even a 10-22 clinker rifle that most kids learn how to shoot with. They could not buy one. If they already owned one, they could not leave their property with that. And not only that, as if that's not bad enough, it made potential felons out of otherwise law-abiding citizens. If you had a criminal break into your home and steal a firearm and go out and commit a crime with that firearm, you as the homeowner could be charged with up to a felony for what that criminal did. The day after that initiative passed, I was asked by citizens if I was going to start arresting 18 to 21 year olds who I saw with a semi-automatic rifle. And my answer to them was, no, I'm not going to do that because it would violate their God-given constitutionally protected rights. And I took an oath of office to uphold and defend the Constitution. You know, we all know what the Second Amendment to the United States Constitution says, right? But a lot of people don't know about the Washington State Constitution because we're not taught it in school, which I want to see changed. But this so-called homeless crisis, right, that's taking over everywhere right now, it did not used to be like this, right? When I was growing up in the 70s, when I was raising my kids in the 80s and 90s, it wasn't like this. Tent cities. Garbage, dirty needles in our parks, everywhere. And it's getting worse, despite the fact that we are spending millions and millions of taxpayer dollars on this problem. But just like most politicians, Jay Inslee is not focusing on the core issue. And when I gave my announcement speech, I didn't call it a homeless crisis, because it's mostly not about homes. It's about an addiction and a mental health crisis in this state, right? You can go to places that are run by Democrats, cities like Seattle, King County, and you can have 7 or 8 grams of heroin on you and the police will not arrest you because the prosecutors will not prosecute. The left says that it's not compassionate to put an addict in jail. I have found exactly the opposite to be true. When I was a narcotics detective, we had a zero tolerance policy. If you have residue of heroin in a baggie in this state, it is a felony. And we would arrest them, they would go to jail, they'd see the judge, and the judge would give them a choice. They can go to treatment, or they can go to prison. And most of them chose treatment. And we had a funny thing start happening. People would get their head clear, they'd get out of the fog. They would get a job, they'd get their kids back, and they would come up to me and give me a hug and thank me for saving their life. So I went out to Westport not too long ago, I talked to a group of people out there, and there used to be 300 charter boats in Westport alone, right? Every boat's got a captain and a crew making a living wage, and then all the support facilities on shore, you know, airlines, rental cars, gas stations, sporting goods, hotels, They've gone from 300 charter boats in Westport alone. I'm not talking about all the other ports and the river guides all across the state, but Westport alone, they went from 300 charter boats down to 28 because our fisheries are so bad. Does it take a brain surgeon to figure this out, right? There's three things that we need to do to fix our fisheries in the state. We need our hatcheries putting out 100% and build more hatcheries where we need them. If the fish aren't going out, they're not coming back. We need to take care of the overpopulated predators. Seals and sea lions piled up at the bottom of dams and mouths of rivers and birds that eat smolt. That can't be allowed. We have to manage all of the wildlife in Washington State, and that includes predators. We need to work on the environment because salmon need clean gravel to spawn in. Those three things. And we will bring back that entire industry across this state. We will bring back that sport fishing, that food for Washington State families. So how about how things were handled downtown Seattle? Chaz Chop, whatever the heck they called it, right? The riots that are still continuing to this day. We see what's going on down in Portland. We see what's going on in Seattle. Inslee didn't even know that they'd taken over part of Seattle. How clueless are you? Have another apple. So the local law enforcement, things started getting out of control down there, right? Obviously. And the local law enforcement and state patrol called for backup. And so the governor is the commander-in-chief of the Washington State National Guard. So when local law enforcement and state patrol called for backup, Jay Inslee sent in the National Guard. But what did he do first? He disarmed them. He sent our young men and women in uniform into a violent situation without the means to protect themselves or other people. And then everybody was pulled out shortly after that, and they started negotiating, right? There's people that own businesses in there, people that work there, people that live there. Those neighborhoods were absolutely being terrorized. Now, I'm all for the Constitution. We all have a First Amendment right to peaceably assemble, attend the church of our choice, freedom of the press, right? But when you start getting violent, when you start looting stores and burning buildings and cars and throwing rocks and frozen water bottles at our police, that is no longer a First Amendment right. That is a crime, and it's called a riot, and it needs to be shut down. The United States government doesn't negotiate with foreign terrorists, and the state of Washington should never negotiate with domestic terrorists either. So when I'm governor and we have another situation like that that starts turning violent, I will have the National Guard spun up and staged close to where the violence is happening. And they will have the means to protect themselves and other people. And they will go in there within minutes and not hours and days like with the current governor, and they will help the local law enforcement to arrest the criminals and put their ass in jail where they belong. That's how you deal with a violent situation. That's how you deal with a riot. You don't appease, you don't negotiate. If you're doing what they were doing, you get arrested and you go to jail. And everyone else would be told to disperse, or they would go to jail as well. That's how you deal with a riot. So, this virus, right? COVID-19. This is a real virus, right? People have died. That's horrible. One death is too many, right? But what did our governor do when this virus started hitting? He decided who's going to go to work and who's not going to go to work, right? Lock us down. We need to flatten the curve. And here we are 6 months later. Where's the curve? It never happened, right? Our hospitals were never overrun. This is a virus that has killed less than 1% of the population, and 60% of those that died were in nursing homes with pre-existing conditions. But he's locked everybody down, and he decided who's essential and who's not essential. We are all essential. If you owned a big box store or an abortion clinic or a pot store, you could stay open, according to our governor. But if you had a church or a gun store or a mom and pop cafe or a salon or barbershop, you had to shut down. Does anybody believe that the virus knows which buildings it can go into and which it can't? Doesn't make any sense, right? Doesn't make any sense. He has shut down businesses all across this state, and a lot of them will never come back. It's people's life savings that are gone, people's jobs that are gone, because he decided. He decided who's going to shut down and who's not. The virus doesn't know just because the governor said so. A barbershop or a salon can operate just as safely as any other store that he left open, right? If you had government construction, if you were working on government construction project, you could go to work. But if you were running a construction company on a residential project, you had to stay home. Does that make any sense? No. Common sense is not in the governor's office. This is not the first virus that we've had, right? We've had bird flu, swine flu, Ebola. They come and they go. When I'm governor and the next virus comes around, I will have press conferences with the medical professionals to explain to everyone what's going on, what we should do to protect ourselves, our family, and our business, what might happen if we don't follow the medical advice, and as governor, make sure the supply chain is as open as possible for the equipment that's needed, and then let free individual citizens decide what's best for themselves, their family, and their business. I have three rules for any bill that comes across my desk that the legislature wants signed into law. Number one, is it constitutional? If it is not constitutional, then I will not sign it. Number two, will it help the citizens of Washington State? Because I'm not working for any special interest group other than we the people. And number three, can we afford it without any new taxes? How about that sex ed bill, right? What a bunch of garbage. That needs to be voted out in November. So I want to tell you a quick story about something that happened in my life. And unlike most politicians, this is a true story. When I was serving the United States military, Barbara and I were married. We had two little boys, Nick and Adam. Nick was about 2.5, Adam was about 1.5. And I was given orders to go overseas on a hardship tour to South Korea. And a hardship tour is, it's too dangerous to bring the family. So I had to leave my little boys and my wife for just a little bit over a year. And I went to South Korea. I was stationed up close to the DMZ. I was in the 2nd Infantry Division. And I spent a year over there. So every year they have a joint military exercise. Every branch of the South Korean military, every branch of the United States military gets together and does a joint military exercise all across the nation of South Korea. And I was in the Army, so when we traveled from one point to another, we were in convoys of military trucks and jeeps. And there are little villages dotted along the dirt roads that we were traveling on, surrounded by rice paddies. And I was a 22, 23-year-old sergeant in the Army. And as the convoy would get close to these villages, all of the people that lived there, little kids, old people, they would all come running up to the edge of the road, and they'd line the edge of the road as the military convoy full of American soldiers went by. And they would be waving with one hand, they'd have a big smile on their face, and in the other hand they would have little American flags that they would wave. And it made me so proud to be an American. These people didn't care what race we were. They didn't care our income, our education, or our gender. They just knew that there was Americans in those vehicles. And we saved them from communism and continued to protect them against the communist North. It made me very proud to be an American, and that has never left me. And we need to remember that here at home. It doesn't matter what your race is, it doesn't matter the color of your skin, or your gender, or your education, or your income. We are all Americans. And we need to remember that here at home. Don't let the left divide us by those things, which they try very, very hard to do. We need to stand up for our freedoms and our liberties and our rights, and stand up like our founders did, like we are fighting for the soul of our state, because we are. Are you with me?
Yeah!
I need your help. Share our Facebook page. Share our website, Culp for Governor. I will be right over here if anybody wants to come up. I'd love to shake your hand and meet you in person. Thank you all very much, and God bless America.